morning, everyone. Today I will be discussing on the basics of Doppler, mainly used in obstetrics, because I've made it so simple and I have kept it so short. So I'll be basically covering on what all you have to do, the settings in the machine, so that you can easily differentiate when you are getting a pathology on the graph, either it is because of the machine, your settings, or whether actually the pathology is there. So before going into the settings, we will talk something about the safety guidelines. Most important thing before starting an obstetric Doppler, on the top of the screen here, you will see TI and MI, something denoted here on your ultrasound screen. That is very important. That is thermal index. The TI is thermal index. That signifies the amount of heat which is produced in the fetus or in the maternal abdomen because of your ultrasound waves. So if you're going to expose the mother for a longer period, this TI, there is going to be ill effects. This has been proved in animal models, but not in human models. But we know that increased temperature in the maternal body will cause teratogenic effects on the fetus. So always keep this TI less than 1. So this is your chart, which is given by the British Medical Ultrasound. You can take a picture of this. You can put it in your ultrasound place where you're doing an ultrasound. See this, if your thermal index is 0.7, your upper limit of ultrasound is 60 minutes. If you're having a thermal index of 1, you can do it for around 30 minutes. If your thermal index is 1.5, you can do it for 15 minutes. And if your thermal index is 2, then you can do an ultrasound only for 4 minutes. And if it is 2.5, you can just do it for only 1 minute. So that is the importance of thermal index. Always keep in mind to keep it low as like less than 1. If it is more than 1, then optimize your time of ultrasound. So coming to pulse wave Doppler, which is the most commonest used in obstetric practice. So here you will see, this is the picture of the keyboard. You can see PW here, this button. When you click this button, this line will appear on screen. This is the line of insonation. This line, which is seen, is the line of insonation, and there is a small equal to in between, which is called gate. Always remember, this line of insonation is nothing but the it denotes like the race, the ultrasound race, how the race is going in that particular place in the screen. So now I will tell you about the importance of this line of insonation. Here I have like 4 probes, like A, B, C, D, each having its own line of insonation, that is the direction of the beam. And you can see the same vessel which is going below. In A, the line of insonation, you can see this line is along the flow of the blood in the vessel. That is the, if you take a degree of measurement between this line and this blood vessel, it will be almost like 0. If this is the case, then the waveform what you get will have a exact velocity of what the vessel blood is having, and you will have an exact waveform of what the vessel is having. If this angle is going to be little altered, see in B, my angle between the probe and this blood vessel is going to be around like 20 to 30 degree. Then what happens? There will be significant, like little reduction in the velocity, but the waveform is still maintained. And in C, when the line of insonation, when it goes like around 50 degrees, here you can see this the angle between this line and the blood flow is around 60 degrees. You can see the wave in C. It is, the wave pattern is lost, and even the velocity is lost. And in D, what happens is when the line of insonation is in opposite direction, that is the blood is going away from this line of insonation, so I'm getting a waveform which is in the opposite, that is below the baseline. So this line of insonation is very important. The inference here is always align your vessel along the line of insonation. In other words, always get a vessel which is more vertical so that you can easily get the 0 degree with the line of insonation. So here I have done a Doppler of MCA, middle cerebral artery. You can see this is my line of insonation and this is my gate. I have put it on the middle cerebral artery at the part where it is so vertical. So now I am getting a proper waveform with a proper velocity. So coming to the next talk. So next topic, that is, will be the angle correction. Angle correction is nothing but, see, all the vessels, you cannot have a vertical vessel. Sometimes it will be a little variation from the like from the midline. In that case, what you can do, something known as angle correction. Angle correction, again, I will show you in the machine. And you see the second knob here, this denoted on screen as angle. This is the angle correction knob. When you change this knob, you can see this straight line, that line of insonation. You will get a small line like this. This is the angle correction line. So now I have turned it into 10 degree, so this small line is gone into 10 degree. So when I change it into around 20 degree, you can see the small line has gone into 20 degree. This is the angle correction line. So if you cannot align your vessel along the insonation angle, try to align it along this small line. But the problem here is when you're going to do an angle correction, if you're doing an angle correction of around 10 degree, your error will be around 2%. If you're doing an angle correction of around 20 degree, your error will be 6%. And if you're doing an angle correction of more than that, like 30 degree, your error will be even more. So always in obstetric practice, have an angle correction less than 30. Try to get it within the midline, that is along the line of insonation. If you cannot, if you are going to do an angle correction, then do it less than 30 degrees. So now I have taken the Doppler of the ductus venosus. You can see the umbilical vein which is coming in and joining the IVC. At the point of aliasing, I have kept my line of insonation with the gate exactly there. But as you know, this ductus venosus is a little angulated, so I have changed the angle into 24 degrees. So this angle correction small line, you can see it is at 24 degrees. So that's why I'm getting a perfect waveform of the ductus venosus here with a normal S wave, D wave, and a A wave. We will be discussing this later. So coming to the next thing. Next thing is gate. As I already told you, the gate is nothing but a small equal to, which is seen in the line of insonation. This gate is exactly from where this machine takes the inputs from that particular vessel. If I'm going to put this gate here, it's going to take signals from this particular region. If I'm going to put it here, it is going to take signals from that particular region. And this gate can be adjusted in height. You can see here my gate is of 8 mm, here it is of 2 mm, it is, here it is of 1 mm. And again, this gate can only be adjusted in height, it cannot be adjusted in the width. So always start with a wider gate, because you want the maximum velocity from that particular vessel to enter into your mission probe. So always start with a wider gate, then start reducing it. The thing is, when you will reduce this, if you are getting signals from the adjacent vessel, like when you're seeing, okay, my next vessel is getting involved within my gate, that means that then you should reduce the gate size. Or else when the velocity of the waveform you are getting when there is like artifacts from the next wave, then again you have to reduce the gate size. So now I have done a Doppler for the tricuspid valve here. See, I have taken a wider gate so that I cover all the three cuffs of the tricuspid. Here, because I don't want to miss out on, if there is any regurgitation on one cuff, I don't want to miss it on it. So I am going to take a wider gate. I have kept my gate size to 2 mm, so I'm getting a waveform without any regurgitation. That means this tricuspid is normal. Coming to the next one, that is ductus venosus. So ductus venosus is a very small vessel, and this was like just a 10 weeks fetus. So I have made it to around just 0.7 mm. Here you can see the size. It is denoted to 0.7 mm. That denotes the gate size. So again, I'm going to get the waveform without any interference from the umbilical vein or from the IVC. I'm going to get only signals from that ductus venosus proper. Sorry. So next, are we clear here? Are you people following? Because this topic, I know it's going to be a little tough. I'm trying to throw some light here. And my next thing is wall filter. Wall filter is nothing but, see, when you're going to put your gate on something in the maternal abdomen, the machine is going to take updates, like whatever substance is moving within the gate will take signals from it. So when you're putting it on a vessel, not only the blood within the vessel is moving, there is also the vessel wall which is moving along with it. So the machine is going to pick up signals from the vessel wall also, but you don't need it. So what you can do, you can like subtract that noise, that unwanted sound from that vessel wall. That is done by something known as wall filter or wall motion filter. I'll show you in the machine where it is. See, this is the fourth knob here. When you adjust this knob, you can see WMF on screen. So this knob, when you adjust, you can alter the wall filter. And always have your wall filter as low as possible, like 50 to 60 Hz. so that you don't miss out on any important findings from that particular vessel. I'll show you some examples here. It is a ductus venosus waveform they have taken. You can see it looks like the PI is increased in this ductus venosus, which all will be dealt today later, but you can see the waveform. Here it goes like little deep, and it looks like there is absence of A wave here. But what happened is there is multiple artifacts seen along the baseline. So now when the wall filter is switched on, you can see there is not only absence of A wave, there is even significant reversal of A wave, which is seen. So this could have been easily missed. So if the wall filter is not switched on. So here I have done a Doppler of the umbilical artery. You can see this is an umbilical artery waveform. Here which I get an increased PA, that is the diastole is very much reduced. And even you can see that some points the diastole is absent. But this is not an abnormal waveform. You can see the date and time of this case. And only thing here is my wall motion filter, that is 500 hertz. Now I am going to change it to just 60 hertz. And this is the normal waveform which I will get. So depending on your wall motion filter or wall filter, even your diagnosis can change. You can just call this one as an abnormal fetus. Here you can see there are multiple absence of diastolic wave. It looks like a complete stage 2, but it is not. It is a complete normal fetus. The only thing different between these two is just the wall filter. You can see here the wall filter is 500 hertz. That's why your diastolic flow is not picked up. And when the wall filter is just 60 hertz, you will get a normal wave pattern. So inference here is always have your wall filter as low as possible, but always have your wall filter switched on. Don't get it switched off. Coming to sweep speed. Sweep speed is nothing but how many waveforms you actually need on screen. That is your sweep speed. Here, this first image has multiple waveforms. You can see this is MCA Doppler. I am seeing multiple waveforms. It is very difficult to measure the indices here and even assess the waveform. This is, I cannot assess it properly. And here, what I'm seeing is I'm only seeing two complete cardiac cycles. So one systole, one diastole, one systole, one diastole. This is half of systole. Again, the diastole is not seen on the third wave. It is always told that you have to take an average of three waveforms to get a proper indices. So now my sweep speed here, my sweep speed is too high. When your sweep speed is high, what happens is the number of waves will become reduced. Here my sweep speed is very low, then the number of waves will get increased. Optimize your sweep speed. This can be done on the machine here, like speed. This is denoted as 1, 2, or 3, 4, 5. In older machines, it will be denoted like 50, 60, 100. In newer machines, it will be like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. They are already preset it accordingly. So when you change it into, like when you increase your sweep speed, the amount of waves will come down. So optimize your speed accordingly. Like there are only four, like minimum of four waves, and the maximum you can get is around 8 to 10 waves. So next topic will be baseline. Baseline is nothing but this white color line you see, this is the baseline. Here I have done all the parameters. I have aligned my line of insonation. I have done an angle correction. I have put my gate, but my waveform looks like this. That means my all the peak of my waves are not seen here. It is seen below this line. That means the baseline is in between. It is in the middle. So now I have moved it down and so that I can see the complete waveform above. Always move your baseline below, and like there should be little amount of space below baseline. That is reversal. Yeah, sorry. So the baseline should be as low as possible so that you get at least 75% of the waveform above the baseline, and there should be a vacant space of 25% above so that you can easily measure it. So this can be done by a knob here. See, the third knob here is denoted as baseline. When you do this, you can align the baseline. You can, like, if you want, you are seeing a reflex, then you can make it go above, and if you are seeing a waveform off, then you can make it come below. So next will be, so now I have made my baseline lower below, but still I'm not seeing my waveform properly. then this means that the velocity of the vessel which I am trying to measure is more than the velocity of the box which is attained here. Here you can see the velocity of this box is around 80, but this vessel is going beyond that. Then what you have to do is you have to correct something known as PRF. This is pulse repetitive frequency. You can see it here. You can see it here, this fifth knob here. If you increase this pulse repetitive frequency, then the frequency of this velocity of this box will get increased. You can see the difference here. I have kept my box velocity to 80. My waveform is not properly seen. But I'm turning it into 160. My waveform is properly seen. So adjust your PRF as if like 75% of your waveform should be seen, and there should be some amount of 25% of vacant space above so that you can measure it easily. Coming to the gain. So like what you do in a 2D, there is a gain that you can increase the color or reduce the color of the grayscale. You can do the same for color Doppler or spectral Doppler. So when you really know the gain is abnormal is, see, I have aligned the line of incidence along this vessel, but I'm not seeing a proper waveform. This can be of two reasons. One is either your gate has moved away from the vessel, or the vessel has moved away from your gate, or the signal is not taken properly by the machine. So this can be of two reasons. Either your gain will be very low. Here you can see the gain is very low, or the vessel is moved. How will you know is, you listen to the audible sound which the machine is making. If the vessel is still under your gate, you will hear the sound properly. If the sound is heard and the graph is not seen, that means your gain is very less. If the sound is not heard, then you have lost the vessel. You have to go and catch the vessel again. So now I have increased the gain. You can see I have kept the gain to 9 here, but I am not happy with the waveform because I'm seeing a lot of artifacts behind this. That means I have made my gain so high that it is obscuring my waveforms. So always keep your gain as optimal so that the waveform is, you are happy with the waveform. It should not be too low, it should not be too high. It can be done by the same button which you press to switch on the PW, that is actually a knob. You can rotate it and you can reduce the gain accordingly, like which waveform you want it. So coming to the next one is color Doppler. Color Doppler is the next commonly used. You can see this CF button here. When you press CF, you'll get the color Doppler. When you press this button, you can see the green box appearing on screen. So anything moving on the screen within this green box will take up color. And the thing is, it is not like arteries are red or veins are blue. It is denoted in the bar here in the top of the screen. This color on the top bar is red and the low is blue. That means in this particular setting, whatever vessel which is bringing blood towards the probe will be red. And whatever vessel which is carrying blood away from the probe will be blue. So this is denoted here. And remember, you can invert it. Just press a button of invert, this color will change. So after we're putting the color box on, now the problem is I'm seeing two vessels. One is completely blue and one is a mixture of red and blue. This means my PRF is very low. Just like the PRF which I did for my spectral Doppler, the same pulse repetitive frequency is for the color here. And this, you can see it is 1.3 kilohertz. Now I have increased for the same patient to 3.2, so that I am seeing two separate vessels and two separate colors. So this will happen when you increase the PRF. So again, for color Doppler, your PRF depends on that vessel. If you're seeing a very low velocity vessel, reduce your PRF. If you're seeing a very high velocity vessel, you need to increase the PRF, or else you will get this mixing of color, which is an artifact which is known as aliasing. So now I have put the color of the circle of Willis here. Apart from the bed vessel, I am seeing multiple color dots here. These are all artifacts, which are actually, there are actually no vessels there. They are just artifacts produced by the machine. These artifacts will be seen if your gain of the color is too high. So if you see these color dots, you can reduce them by reducing the gain. Again, just like our gain for a 2D or a spectral Doppler, this gain can be reduced by the knob in the CF button itself. If you reduce that gain, you will not have this color dots around your Doppler. So coming to angle of inclination. Color Doppler also has some effect on angle of insertion. Here you are seeing a single umbilical cord which is running. I am getting some color signals from this part and this part, but I am not getting any color signal in this region. It doesn't mean there is a reduced velocity in that region. It simply means that the color, the direction of blood here is at 90 degree to your probe. So whenever it is at 90 degree, obviously there is not going to be any Doppler effect or very, very reduced Doppler effect. So there won't be much of color uptake at that region. This cannot be adjusted anything on the machine. You can just avoid it by turning your probe. Just adjust your probe so that you will get it a vertical region. Coming to power Doppler. Power Doppler is, you can use it in wherever, like the very low velocity vessels you are seeing where the color, you don't need the color, you can use a power Doppler. All the principles of color Doppler are operate same, except that the angle of insertion has less effect on it. And one more thing is there won't be much of aliasing in it. So coming to the vessels we are gonna see in an obstetric Doppler. So first thing which we will be seeing is an uterine artery. So uterine artery, you can easily see an uterine artery in the first trimester. Just have an empty bladder, put your probe on the midline of the mid sagittal plane, then get your image of the cervix, then move it a little lateral, you will see a vessel which is coming from the cervix, which is going towards the fundus of the uterus. That is your uterine artery. And in the same region, I will show you the video here. It's not getting played. Previous, I come to the previous one. Yeah, play it. So from the midline, I'm just going laterally. I am seeing a single vessel which is coming from the cervix going towards the uterus. This is my uterine artery. In the same region, you will get arcuate arteries or you will get cervicovaginal arteries. Don't mistake them for the uterine artery. You can easily differentiate them with the velocity. Just take a spectral waveform of the vessel which you are getting here. If you are getting a like a peak systolic velocity less than 50, then it is not your uterine artery. If you're getting a peak systolic velocity of more than 50, then it is your uterine artery. So coming to the second trimester, evaluation of uterine artery is, uterine artery is little laterally placed in the second trimester. You cannot apply the same rule which you applied in the first trimester. Now you have to place your probe on the lateral side of the abdomen, like lower lateral quadrant, and just angulate it medially. You will see the crossing of the external iliac vessel. This is the external iliac vessel, and you will be seeing one more artery which is going like this. That artery which is crossing the external iliac artery is your uterine artery. Video. So you can see this is your uterine artery which is arising. So you can always place your gate or always measure this uterine artery 1 centimeter away from the crossing of the external iliac. But this vessel should not get divided, like it should not branch before your division, before your measurement. So if it is gonna branch before, like even if it is branching before the external iliac crossing, then take it before the external iliac crossing itself. So coming to the transvaginal assessment of the uterine artery, if you want to do it transvaginally, then you have to keep your probe in the first trimester, keep it in the anterior fornix, angulate it laterally, you will find your uterine artery there. Rest, all the principles are same as the transabdominal. If you want to do it in the second trimester, place your transvaginal probe in the lateral fornix and angulate it little laterally, you will get your uterine artery there. And remember, if you're going to do it transvaginally, the reference charts for transvaginal is different. You cannot use the same reference charts you are using for the transabdominal. So both are different. So you have to take a particular reference chart according to the modality which you are viewing the uterine artery. Coming to the next commonest is the umbilical artery. Umbilical artery, you can measure it at the placental end, free loop, or at the fetal end. And at the fetal end, the impedance of the artery is little high. So whenever if there is going to be any reversal or if there is going to be any absence of diastolic wave, it is going to happen first at the fetal end. So it is always better to take at the free loop. So for like a common reference charts are made on the free loop and it is always easy to get. And in case of multiple pregnancies, you can do it in the near the fetal end or in the intra-abdominal portion. But the problem here is if you're going to do that, then you have to use the particular reference chart for it. For fetal end, you have a different reference chart, and for free loop, you have a different reference chart. So again here, I have taken a Doppler of the umbilical artery. I have aligned my vessel along the line of insonation. I have put my gate there. So I'm getting proper velocity with the proper waveform. Coming to the middle cerebral artery. Middle cerebral artery, have you thought like why they choose the middle cerebral artery? Out of all the arteries in the brain, they could have chosen the ACA, they could have chosen the PCA, or they could have chosen even the ICA. Why did they choose MCA? Because that is one vessel which you can easily get that 0 degree with your probe. Because it is coming exactly vertical to your probe, so it is easy for you to get that 0 degree. And one more thing is that the MCA has 80% of your cerebral circulation. So you take a BPD section, you see your KM septum pellucidum, you see your thalamus. Go a little below, at the place of your sphenoid wing, you will see a vessel which is coming towards your probe. This is your middle cerebral artery. This is your opposite middle cerebral artery. Always measure the middle cerebral artery which is coming towards you. That is the nearer middle cerebral artery. And always measure the M1 segment. That is after the division, see this part, after the division of ICA, measure the first segment, M1 segment of the middle cerebral artery, because as the middle cerebral artery runs, the velocity of the middle cerebral artery gets reduced. So it is always better to take the M1 segment. So coming to ductus venosus. Ductus venosus, as I already told you, it is nothing but just from the umbilical vein, which goes and directly connects the IVC. At this point, it is a very narrow vessel, so there will be an increased velocity at this point. So there will be an aliasing, which you will see in color. So I have taken a mid-sagittal view of the abdomen, and I am getting a single point of aliasing. This is nothing but my ductus venosus. So when you find your ductus venosus, put your gate on the ductus venosus, you will get a waveform of the ductus venosus like this. Ductus venosus waveform has like S wave. This is the S wave which denotes the systole of the ventricle. And this is your D wave which denotes the diastole of the ventricle. And this is your A wave which denotes the atrial contraction. So coming to the next vessel, which is more important, is aortic isthmus. Aortic isthmus is the only arterial connection between the right ventricle and the left ventricle. You can see aortic isthmus is a small part of aorta between the left subclavian and the ductus connection. This part is called the isthmus of the aorta. What happens here is, see, from the left ventricle, blood from the ascending aorta goes to the arch of aorta. Majorly, it goes into the cerebral circulation, and rest of the vessels go into the rest of the blood goes into the descending aorta. And from the blood from the right ventricle, what it happens, it goes through the pulmonary artery, enters the ductus arch, and it again goes into the descending aorta. So when you're going to put a gate on the just on the isthmus of aorta, that is this portion after the origin of subclavian, here there is going to be only a forward flow. That is the blood from here, it's maximum is going towards the descending aorta. Nothing is going to come back here. So when there is a redistribution of blood, when there is brain sparing effect, from the right ventricle, what happens is the blood through the ductus venosus tries to come back to the cerebral circulation. That is when you get a reversal in this diastolic. See here, this is the waveform. I have kept my gate on the isthmus of the aorta here properly. And this is my systole and this is my diastole. In this diastole, I'm not getting any reversal. If I get a reversal here, that means there is a brain sparing effect. That is, there is brain from the right ventricle is going back into the cerebral circulation. So, which indices to use now? Okay, We have taken all the vessels. There are multiple indices, and most commonly used is this systole by diastole, S by D, RI and PI. These three are the most commonly used. But now, recently, PI is the most commonly used thing, because here you can see the formulas here. In RI, when you're like, this is systole minus diastole divided by, again, peak systolic velocity. So when you're having an absence of diastole, that is when your D is zero, what happens here is when you put a zero here, it becomes like S by S is one. So the maximum RI, what you're going to get is going to be one. And like same happens to S by D ratio. In S by D ratio, you put a zero in D. What happens? It becomes infinity. Whenever you divide anything by zero, it becomes infinity. So it is always better to do a PI rather than an RI or an SD. So even when you're having an absence of diastole, you will still have a value of PA. Even if you're having a reversal, then you will still have a PA. Because see, here it is systole minus diastole by the average of both. So PA is one of the most common indices used now, because it will have a value throughout whatever the pathology, you will still have a value. So take home points for today is always have your line of insonation along the vessel, or else get your vessel as vertical as possible. Put your gate as a wider gate and try to start reducing it when you get signals from the adjacent vessels. If you cannot align your vessel along the line of insonation, try to do an angle correction, but never do it more than 30 degrees. And you keep your sweep speed accordingly so that you like get at least like 4 to 8 or 10 waves. You don't want anything less than that or anything more than that. And adjust your PRF according to the vessel. If you're seeing a low velocity vessel, reduce your PRF. If you are seeing a high velocity vessel, increase your PRF. Thank you so much for the patient listening.